Now, the first linear model that we are going to look at is free undamped motion. So that will be akin to a spring, a mass that's hanging from a spring and pulled down a little bit and let go, so it's going to oscillate up and down. And for now, in this first example, we imagine that there's no external force. In other words, there's no friction, there's no air resistance, and certainly no changes in the spring itself, so that it can indefinitely just move up and down, down to the same spot, up to the same spot, to infinity, which is a bit unrealistic. But let's construct using this linear second order differential equation with constant coefficients of ours to see if we can get to an equation which at any time t will tell us at what position we'll find this mass. Now, as I said, we're going to use this equation, but most of these will have initial values. So at time equals zero, this position of ours would be called y sub zero. The first derivative of position we know is velocity, and we're going to have some velocity at time equals zero. Imagine that spring is hanging there, and instead of just letting it go so it can go up, I give it some velocity, either pushing it down, letting it go, or shoving it upwards as I let it go, so it has some initial velocity as opposed to a zero velocity when you just let it go. So we have to start with Hooke's law, and Hooke's law says within the constraints of not overstretching a spring that the restoring force, so if I would pull a spring out, it will want to go back, and that is proportional to the distance that I pull it out. And I can then therefore introduce a constant of proportionality, we'll call it K, which is the spring constant, and that describes the spring completely. So for instance, if I hang 10 newtons worth of weight from the spring, and it pulls that spring out 5 centimeters there, then I can just have K equals F divided by S, so that's 10 divided by 0.05 newtons per meter, and that would be my spring constant. To get to an equation for free undamped motion or oscillatory motion, I need Newton's second law as well. Now, let's just consider downwards towards the paper as the positive direction. And as you can see, we're calling this up and down motion x in these examples. So there'll be this restoring force in the spring equal to Ks. Now we'll note later on it's negative Ks because we're taking positive in the downward direction, so upward is negative. And the mass that we hang from the end of the spring, well, we know that that's equal to mg, the mass of the object times the gravitational acceleration, the g. So at equilibrium, I've put the block on, it hangs there, and it stands still. At equilibrium, mg has got to equal Ks, or mg minus Ks. Mg is positive, Ks is negative. If I had two vectors, that's going to be zero. Now, there's going to be a new force, now obviously, because that spring, there's going to be a new restoring force, in as much as that spring has now been pulled down an extra bit of distance. So now we're going to have this restoring force being negative Kx plus S. It's going to be the new upward force on that spring. Now, because there is this resultant, I've pulled it down and I'm holding it there, so from the equilibrium position, which already has at that equilibrium force pulling up, the weight pulling down, now I pull it down, so there's going to be now a new restoring force because of this extra distance I've pulled it down, and this distance is positive x. So I've got to add the two distances now, that this S that it was at equilibrium plus this extra X that I'm moving it, so that's going to be the new restoring force, but there is not equilibrium between these forces, they don't cancel out anymore as it was there in equilibrium. Now, the force in the negative direction is going to be more, it's going to pull this mass up as soon as I let go, so that's going to give us some form of resultant force. Now, force equals mass times acceleration, which I have there, M, and then that's the second derivative in time of the position, that's acceleration. So it's negative kx plus s in the negative direction and still the mg down. And just a very simple algebra, so I've just expanded there. But I do remember something. I know that mg equals ks, or mg minus ks is zero, so this mg minus ks, that goes to zero, or that is zero. So we're left with mx, the mx prime prime equals negative kx. Well, I can bring that to the other side, and I've got this homogeneous equation, and if I divide throughout by this constant, mass is a constant here, I'm left with this second order linear differential equation with constant coefficients, and it's homogeneous. Now, we'll see later that we can describe k over m as this omega squared, and omega is the angular velocity. Well, I should say angular frequency. The circular frequency is not velocity. The circular frequency. In other words, if I let this go up and down, or we've all seen that, if you have a circular motion, and instead of viewing that circular motion, uniform circular motion, instead of viewing it side on like this, if we started to view it edge on, this is all you'll see. So any kind of oscillatory motion like this, if you viewed it from the side, would be this. And if you took any spot, it goes around the circle at some radians per second. Okay, that is the angular frequency. Now that's radians per second as far as the velocity is concerned, but the frequency of it's concerned is in seconds, how many radians, a change in radians will take place. Okay, not important for understanding this linear equation, but we, for simplicity's sake, set the spring constant divided by the mass equal to omega, that's lowercase omega squared. So we're just rewriting k over m then as omega squared. Now we can just rewrite this as x prime prime omega squared x. We can write it in differential form, which will be that. Because it's homogeneous, we can write the auxiliary equation, which is going to leave us with m being positive or negative omega I, which we know now we can solve as, with alpha being 0, as c sub 1 cosine omega t and c sub 2 sine of omega t. Now the period of oscillation, so it's beautiful this in as much as now we have an equation for x. At any time t, I can work out exactly where this mass will be. So the period of oscillation, now if we just look at a sine curve here, remember the period of oscillation is how long it takes for one complete wave. So from any point up, down, back to that point, how long that will take. And that is 2 pi over omega. The frequency is 1 over the period. The frequency is how many waves are going to pass by per second. So if this was moving fast, how many times is the block going to move in the same direction past some observer in 1 second? So that would be omega over 2 pi. And I just remind you that omega is then the square root of the spring constant divided by mass, or it's also called the circular frequency of the system.